Spring, 1963. Modesto, California. George Lucas is in his second year at Modesto Junior College, studying anthropology and literature.
You coming tonight, George?
You bet.
George has taken an interest in art house films. You couldn't see those in Modesto, so he and his friends would drive up to San Francisco for screenings. His lifelong friend John Plummer has also encouraged him to apply to the world-renowned film school at the University of Southern California. In the mail was an official-looking envelope from USC.
John, look!
There it is! You gonna open it or what?
I am pleased to announce your admission to the University of Southern California. Oh my God, I got in!
You got in?
I'm in!
USC was a private university, and George needed his father's help to pay the tuition. He'd get the money on one condition, that he'd treat his studies like a full-time job. But his dad still wasn't sure if there'd be a career for his son in film.
I'm holding a place for you at the store, George.
Dad, I don't want to run a company. I'm never coming back.
George held up his end of the bargain. At USC, he'd work night and day on his studies, and his student films, too. With friends like John Milius, who would later become a writer and director, Walter Murch, who would become a legendary sound designer, and a beautiful girl named Marcia Griffin, who wanted to become an editor.
Did you do the 506 assignment?
I can't keep up with taking so many photos.
USC was an incubator of budding filmmakers, and though George didn't know it yet, he was already making his way to the top. His next student film was about a futuristic, dystopian world. It would become his calling card for decades. THX-1138. Spring, 1977, Hollywood. George Lucas is 32 years old. Doctors have given a death sentence. Either for him or for Star Wars, George was defiant.
Well, that's gotta go. No, that's gotta go.
He's in his office, slashing apart the script for Star Wars, shot by shot.
Now that one stays.
That one was the Millennium Falcon's jump to hyperspace. That one was crucial to the film. George began spending 2 days a week at ILM, trying to make up lost time, and hiring help to oversee them when he couldn't be there. He became overbearing and strict. If they weren't going to get all the shots done, they'd at least get the important ones.
Cannon going boom, boom, boom. An explosion in a wall panel.
John Dykstra had run the place like a free-spirited collective. That's why he and George had always gotten along. Creativity came first. But now, they were out of time.
I need this shot done. Today.
George put his foot down. He felt like a jerk. These were his friends, and he was treating them like employees. They were employees. His creative vision had become a business. In some ways, he felt cold, just like his dad. But as Star Wars continued to unravel, there was no other way.
Hey, Gary.
Hey, George.
Please give me good news.
In slashing scenes from the film, George had added a few new lines of dialogue. Those required some reshoots, but Fox wasn't making it easy.
Well, they say 20,000 is all we get.
20,000? I can't reshoot for 20,000.
We're 2 million over budget, George. We're tapped out.
The reshoot problem got even worse after actor Mark Hamill broke his nose and cheek in a car accident. It made his reshoots impossible. All George would get is a few days in the California desert. He knew that was it. He'd have to make it work. Meanwhile, Steven Spielberg is also in LA, doing test screenings for his first cut of Close Encounters of the Third Kind. The reaction is lukewarm, at best.
All right, wait. How did they know where the aliens were showing up?
The whole thing about the nerve gas hoax?
So, was it all supposed to be a dream?
Steven was feeling the pressure once more. This time, he had a film with structural problems, not mechanical ones like on Jaws. He needed rewrites, reshoots, and money to do it. Columbia Pictures saw parallels to the troubled Star Wars picture at Fox, which had become a bit of a rival project. Steven would get his reshoots, but the film's release would push back from summer to November that year. Star Wars would get a 6-month head start, and Steven worried by then there might be no audience left for Close Encounters. Spring, 1977.
Brian, good to see you, pal.
Nice place, George. Look at that screen.
George and Marcia have invited their friends over to watch the film.
I already called front row.
Steven, of course you did.
Hello, Brian. Alan Ladd Jr., Fox.
On Marsh's advice, the new cut of the film includes a completely new version of Luke's trench run on the Death Star at the end of the film, and Han Solo swooping in with the Millennium Falcon to save the day. If people didn't cheer at that, the movie wouldn't work. They were about to find out.
Oh, by the way, Marty apologizes he can't be here. He was excited to see it.
It was a reunion of the movie brats. Martin Scorsese wouldn't make it, and Francis Ford Coppola was in Manila shooting Apocalypse Now. But Steven, Brian De Palma, John Milius, writer Gloria Katz, and a couple executives from Fox, including Laddie, wouldn't miss it for the world.
Hey, popcorn?
See, this is what I'm talking about. It's all about the experience.
Hey, let's go ahead with Reel 1.
Yes, sir, Reel 1.
I should mention we're still missing the special effects, so I put in some World War II dogfight footage in there instead. Also, Johnny's doing this great score for the film, but that's not in there either.
How about the photography? Have you shot anything yet, George?
Shut up, Ryan.
Hey, shut up, Ryan.
The film opened with shaky text. A primitive, long-winded version of what would become the iconic yellow opening crawl. And the first pictures of the film itself were handwritten notes that said, "Huge space cruiser here."
Wait, so is all that text just a placeholder?
Where was this big, expensive movie?
No, it's more background for the story.
It was just the start of what would be a nightmare screening. The longest 2 hours of George's life.
So this part will be different. And with the music, this sequence is going to be a lot more intense.
Remember, a Jedi can feel the Force flowing through him.
Most scenes required explanation to make sense.
Watch for enemy fighters.
They're coming in.
Three marks at 210.
Marsha was relieved the trench run scene got a cheer from Steven. But when they got to the film's final scene, the throne room, there was total silence. No music, no sound. A strange, boring ending for an adventure movie. When the end credits rolled, no one applauded or spoke. The silence sank George deep into his chair. It was clearer now than ever. Star Wars was terrible. Marsha broke into tears. Not even Steven knew what to say.
That bad, huh?
I don't mean to sound harsh, but what is this shit?
Marsha leaned over to her friend Gloria, sitting next to her.
Oh, it's awful.
Shh, there are people from the studio here.
It's like the At Long Last Love of sci-fi.
Shh.
At Long Last Love was a musical starring Frank Sinatra, widely considered one of the worst films of all time. Marsha's heart broke for George, who was bright red with embarrassment, slumped down in his chair. He tried to save the moment.
Well,
at least for the Fox executives in the room.
It is a kid's movie, of course. Walt Disney kind of thing. It's going to do 8-10 million. It's a kid's movie, you know?
Yeah, it's a kid's movie, Brian, with the special effects and music. Hey, I can see a really fun movie.
It was Laddie whose opinion really mattered, and he'd been the only person at Fox that still believed in the movie. For a moment now, it wasn't so clear.
I think it's good, George. Very entertaining kids' movie.
It was the polite way of saying the movie wasn't what it was supposed to be.
I'm gonna take off, George. Thanks again.
As the executives from Fox left, the movie brats followed tradition and went to dinner. Chinese food. George was silent in the car. Silent at the restaurant. More than an hour passed before he worked up the courage to speak again.
All right. What do you guys really think?
George had a notepad. He sat at the table, piled high with empty dishes yet to be cleared, and begged his peers for help. This persistence had saved him before, but his friends knew it wouldn't this time.
Well, George?
It was Brian.
Okay, the first act. Where are we? Who are the fuzzy guys? Who is this Tin Man from The Wizard of Oz? What kind of movie is this? We have no idea what's going on. You've left the audience out.
Brian was relentless. Several times, George and Steven tried to defend the story, but Brian continued.
And what's all this the Force shit? It sounds like farts. May the farts be with you.
George was still bright red and humiliated.
And you gotta drop the Jedi shit. Nobody's gonna know what you're talking about.
He made notes on his notepad. He saw the only way out was to figure out what he'd messed up so badly.
You know, George, it's definitely rough, but I don't know that I agree with Brian. The story is great.
Oh, come on, Steve.
Honestly, this thing could make $100 million. I'm serious. It has heart. People like that. You get those shots put in and Johnny's music in there, you're gonna have a hit.
By the end of the night, George had his list of plot holes and problems, and after Steven's show of support, Brian offered to help fix the film and rewrite what would become the iconic opening crawl. Anvil Studios, England, a few miles away from London. It was a recording stage for music used by some of the celebrated composers of the last decade. Bernard Herrmann for Vertigo, Jerry Goldsmith for The Omen. The walls of this great big room had history. And John Williams was about to record with the London Symphony Orchestra for the first time. George was in a smaller room, the control room, separated by soundproof glass. In front of him, an enormous mixing board and his sound crew.
George, how was the flight?
That was Lionel Newman, the head of music for Fox. He'd made the trip from Los Angeles along with George and, of course, John Williams, who they could see standing at the podium on the other side of the glass.
We didn't have a score on American Graffiti. I'm not sure what to expect.
Are you in for a treat?
John wore a black turtleneck and reading glasses, carefully scanning the sheet music before they begin recording with the orchestra. On the wall of this enormous stage is a projected image of Luke Skywalker, 34 feet across. In front of the screen is a semicircle of fine wood and brass instruments, all lined up facing John at the podium.
If we're ready, shall we begin?
It was John over the intercom.
All the levels are set.
Ready when you are, George.
May the Force be with us.
John grasped the baton and held it up vertically as if casting a musical spell over the orchestra.
One and two and.
It's the greatest music anyone in that control room has ever heard.
Oh my God. Incredible. Unbelievable.
They can't believe the only thing between them and the magic being played by the London Symphony Orchestra is just a pane of glass.
Call Steven.
George fumbles to dial out to Steven in Los Angeles.
Can you get Steven on the phone? It's urgent.
George, what do you think?
Johnny, it's brilliant. It's already the best part of the movie.
Ladies and gentlemen of the London Symphony Orchestra, welcome to Star Wars.
As John conducted, George watched the film play on the screen above. It was dazzling. The images sparkled with life, more vibrant than they'd ever been before.
George, I've got Steven on the line.
Steve, you were right about Johnny. Listen to this.
George holds up the phone so Steven can hear the music.
This man is a genius, Steve.
Steven listened for half an hour. An international long-distance call that would cost the studio nearly $600. John's baton held an astonishing command over the orchestra for a recording that would be considered among the greatest musical works of all time. The cast, who were still in London, had heard the buzz about John's score. They had to hear this. Many of them had come in, now huddled in a cramped control room with George. Carrie Fisher was moved to tears. They all held their breath as John conducted the final cue. George walked out to give a big hug to his composer, who was now visibly weary from hours of emotional conducting.
Johnny, come here.
Oh.
It took John by surprise.
Was it all right?
Johnny, it was... I'm speechless.
It was the only thing that had gone right. And boy, was it right. Stephen would later admit he was worried he'd never hear something so wonderful as that music. George had brought out the very best of John Williams to save Star Wars. George left London on top of the world. On the flight to Los Angeles, he fantasized about the future of Star Wars. Could it still make the splash Jaws did after all this trouble? 1,000 movie theaters, lines around the block. He'd have 12 hours on a plane to think about it, and was still worried the music might have come too late. George was back in the warm California sun. As he rushed his teams to finish the special effects shots and the sound mix, he got a note from Alan Ladd Jr. at Fox.
What's this?
He just said to call him back when you have a minute.
Hey, George.
Hey, Laddie.
I don't want to sugarcoat it. A lot of local theaters aren't sure about the film. We're not getting the numbers we thought we'd get.
Well, how many theaters do we have?
Well, it's not good, George.
Laddie, how many?
About 30.
Laddie could almost feel George's dismay through the phone.
Okay.
We're gonna keep working on it, George. But we had an idea. The movie comes out on Memorial Day weekend, and they're thinking we might be able to get a little word of mouth if we release it a few days early on Wednesday.
It was unusual, but a move Laddie said might help the opening weekend numbers, especially for a limited release.
Won't that look desperate?
Theaters had no interest in Star Wars. They thought it looked silly and wouldn't make money. In fact, the title was so unpopular that Fox had to threaten to withhold another movie later that summer that was more anticipated, The Other Side of Midnight. Theaters wouldn't get that one unless they also showed Star Wars. 20th Century Fox feared a flop.
Mr. Spielberg's office.
Hey, it's George for Steve.
Still weeks from release, George has lost all hope. He sees the writing on the wall. The epic sci-fi adventures Fox has been touting for 2 years is no more than a mediocre kids movie.
Hey, buddy.
Hey, Steve. Listen, I know you're doing some rewrites, but I'm thinking about going to Hawaii opening weekend. You want to come?
Why? That's Memorial Day weekend? Yeah.
Just get away from the press, you know?
Count me in. It'll be good just to relax for a couple days.
Yeah, great, great. It's a good hotel on the Big Island. It's perfect.
Yeah, I'm in. Hey, George, what if the press is good?
George couldn't find a way to tell Steven Star Wars was only getting a limited release.
Well, I'm not sure it will be.
They booked their tickets. When Star Wars arrived, they planned to be in a galaxy far, far away.